Hello YouTube, SentinalhMC here for episode 12 of my RotaryCraft tutorial series. So the last episode we talked about the sonic boar and the item vacuum, and as promised, this time we're talking about the Bedrock Breaker. The Bedrock Breaker is your gateway to the best tools and machines that you can get in RotaryCraft. Unbreakable tools and armor with built-in enchants can all be yours, as well as a number of machines that require bedrock dust to be crafted. So let's get straight into this, because there's a bit to cover. The Bedrock Breaker is not a very complicated machine at all. You just set it, give it power, and it goes. Let's see how to make it. So it's really, really easy to craft. It's three blocks of obsidian, a steel ingot, two diamonds, and three base panels. So it's also really, really simple to craft. Just a couple of diamonds and some obsidian. So, you know, if you... You might use that obsidian factory to make your obsidian if you don't want to make a diamond pick, but you get your Bedrock Breaker. So you'll notice there's a couple more tables here, but we're going to talk about that in a minute, because I just want to talk about the Bedrock Breaker first. So let's come over here to this little hole in the ground. Now, the Bedrock Breaker requires 524 kilowatts of energy at power at 8,192 newton meters of torque. So what that is basically, that's half the torque of a hydrokinetic engine, but all of the maximum power output. Which means that the easiest way to power a Bedrock Breaker, in my opinion, is with a hydrokinetic engine. Because the hydrokinetic engine can give us both the torque and the power. So here we have a giant hole in the ground. This was dug with a pile driver. And go down here, I've got a Bedrock Breaker set up. You place it on the ground, and you point the drill bit down at the bedrock. Of course, you don't have to point it down if there's like a hole in the bedrock and it's uneven, because sometimes it is. You can turn it. This thing has a four block range, the Bedrock Breaker. It can break bedrock up to four blocks in front of it, but it can't break the very, very bottom layer. So you cannot mine into the void. You cannot break into the void using the Bedrock Breaker. It does not work. So the Bedrock Breaker, you put your... First of all, let me just place it so you can see what it looks like on the front. So this is the part that does all the digging. You can see that it's made out of obsidian. It's got some diamond behind it. This hole always faces up. And it seems to always face up. But you'll put the power in the back of it. Whatever side is opposite this, that's where you put your power. And I'm pretty sure it will output to a chest if you put a chest next to it. I'm not for sure, though. So, how to power this thing? Well, like I said, you're gonna need basically the entire output of a hydrokinetic engine to power this. And since you don't already have access to bedrock, there's shafts, there's really no good way to send a bunch of power down a hole this deep. So here is what I would recommend. The way I would power a Bedrock Breaker, if I dug a hole like this, which you could dig with a pile driver or whatever else you wanted, is that I would actually build a hydrokinetic engine down here in the hole. And once you've got it built in the hole, get yourself a bunch of lubricant and put it in there, and then just pour water over the edge of the hole, and depending on how deep this hole is, I mean, there should easily be 64 blocks of height to drop the water from, and if not, just add a couple more. Like, if we see what we got here, up to 64 is, yeah, like right here. So just dump the water over the edge, and it'll power your hydrokinetic engine. And then if you just put a bevel gear there, right off the engine, right into your Bedrock Breaker, then you can get your first bits of bedrock, enough to make bedrock shafts. Because at... if we go into here and we go to shaft load limits, you can use diamond shafts for this. So if you wanted to use your diamonds for shafts, you could go ahead and use those to transmit power, but there's no way you're going to want to build enough diamond shafts to go from the surface to the bottom. So I would highly recommend digging a hole like this, maybe with the pile driver or the sonic borer, and then just build a hydrokinetic engine at the bottom of it, dump water over the edge, and power your Bedrock Breaker. So let's turn this on. I've got this industrial coil set to 32 radians per second at 16,384 newton meters, which is the exact output of a hydrokinetic engine. And if we let me just break some bedrock so we can see this. there is the Bedrock Breaker grinding away at the bedrock. So its operational speed with this much power is 22 seconds. This is twice the torque that it asks for, but it's just the same amount of power. And what this is going to do is it's going to incredibly slowly, and when I say slowly, I mean slowly, grind away, and let's just hit this with the angular transducer. Yep, it's getting enough power. It's going to very slowly grind away at this bedrock, and once we hit the 22 second mark, there, did you see that? There's nothing in here. Did you see what happened there? This piece of bedrock is now ever so slightly shorter than the bedrock behind it. That's going to happen every 22 seconds. So at this amount of power, every 22 seconds, a chunk of that size will get ground off the bedrock. And you won't get your bedrock dust until this entire block is gone. So the Bedrock Breaker is very slow. Very slow. You need to give it tons and tons of power to get it to go faster. See, it just did it again. So now there's even more bedrock missing. This thing doesn't make a sound. But you can see it's slowly grinding away at the bedrock block. This is another reason I would recommend using the hydrokinetic engine, because you can set it and forget it, and then it'll just work, and then you just come back much later and see how much bedrock you've got. This is the Bedrock Breaker. If I go ahead and give this some more speed, let's give this 64. So now we're at a megawatt, which would be, not quite. Two hydrokinetic engines would only turn at 32, but they would give twice as much torque. So let me go ahead and do that. Let's just turn this to 32, and then we'll double this to whatever double this is. I'm just going to type 32,000, which is not quite accurate, but we're still going to get a megawatt. And now this is still at 22.4 seconds. That's because the Bedrock Breaker increases in operational speed with the speed, not the torque. So give it just the amount of torque that it needs, and then give it speed and speed it up. But this is going to go very slowly. But eventually, it's going to break it, and it's going to give us some bedrock dust here. So let me just give this a ridiculous amount of power at 4 megawatts, and it's still going to take 19 seconds. So let me give this a really ridiculous amount of power at 16 megawatts, and that's still going to take 16.45 seconds. Let's give this an even more ridiculous amount of power at 32 megawatts. Now it's down to 15 seconds. And if we just go in here and type blah, 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 a totally outrageous amount of power at 3.2 gigawatts, now it's taking 5 seconds per slice. So you can see the Bedrock Breaker takes a ridiculous amount of power if you want to speed this thing up. I mean, 3.2 gigawatts, that's crazy. We don't need to give it 3.2 gigawatts. If I take this back to 16,000 newton meters, you can see that it doesn't really matter. It's the speed that's important. So if we drop this down to the 8,100, 8,192, which is what it wanted, and at a speed of crazy, you may need like a gigawatt or less than a gigawatt to do it. Now, what happened to that? Okay, I see. Okay, so it doesn't output into a chest. It just keeps it in. It's got like an internal inventory, and then when you right click on it, it spits it out for you. So let me just ramp this up to ridiculous. All right. Now if I right-click on it a bunch of times, I've got the bedrock dust. So yeah, I just gave it more power than you would ever give it, but that got it down to 0.05 seconds, but just so we could break through some more bedrock. So that's the Bedrock Breaker. It takes a lot of power, but you can run it off of a hydrokinetic engine, that's how I would run it. It's just going to take a really, really long time. But, you know, set it up, go do something else, come back and check on it every... 10 minutes, check on it in 10 minutes, if you might have some. That's the Bedrock Breaker. Now we've got Bedrock Dust. And RotaryCraft, a lot of the machines, and then the shafts and gears, they use the Bedrock Dust. So, if all you want to do at this point with Bedrock is make this pressure head, which we'll talk about what this is for later. Or if all you want to do is make shaft units and gears so that you can make bedrock gearboxes and bedrock shaft units, then you really don't have to watch the rest of this video right now, because that's, you use the dust for that. But now we're going to talk about how you can get bedrock ingots. Because bedrock ingots are what you're going to need if you want to make the bedrock tools and armor. And they're pretty darn awesome, because bedrock tools are indestructible. You see the pickaxe has a built-in silk touch, and the sword has sharpness and looting 5 and does 12 damage a hit. The helmet has projectile protection 4, the boots have feather falling 4, the chestplate has blast protection 4, and then the leggings have fire protection 4. So the bedrock armor and tools are really, really good. So if you want to get those, you're going to need bedrock ingots. And that's when we're going to have to crack out our old friend, the blast furnace. And so now let's talk about how we can get that to work. So in order to create bedrock ingots, you have to heat a blast furnace up to 1,000 degrees C. And you can't do that with lava. It doesn't matter how many lava blocks you put around it. It's never going to go higher than 625. So there are two ways to do it, as I see it. The way I would probably do it, and then, I don't know. Both ways have their merits, but I'm going to show you both of them. So one way you can do it is with a friction heater, and I'm just going to set up this industrial coil. So with a friction heater, you would have to give it, and I have it written down, 256 newton meters at 1024 radians per second. Actually, let me put a dynamometer on here so you can see how much power that is, because that'll give you the idea of what kind of generator you would need to use for it. So we'll do that. We'll put the industrial coil back down. Put the lever. We'll give it the 256 newton meters at 1024 radians per second. And when we crank it on, you can see that 262 kilowatts, which is the output of a performance engine with additives, will get the friction heater to heat up to 1,000 degrees, which will obviously heat the blast furnace to 1,000 degrees. So it's at 1,000 radians per second, 256 newton meters of torque. Well, it's not 1,000, it's 1024. So yeah. Okay, come on. You worked earlier. Oh, I know why it worked earlier. It worked earlier because I was doing it in the desert. Okay, so let me break this stuff off and actually get it to work, like the stupid person that I am. So, friction heater, I still want to put a dyno here just so that we can see it. Put down the coil, put down the bevel gear. 256 newton meters at 1024 radians per second. Power this up. And now that we're in the desert, and this starts off at 40 C, it has enough power to get us up to 1,000. Because I knew it was working earlier. I was like, why didn't it work just now? But that's because the ambient temperature was lower. And this should pop up to just over 1,000. 8, 9, there it is, 1,000. So this will turn yellow, and then that tells us that we're at 1,000 C. So if you want to do it this way, just set it up in a desert biome so that the ambient temperature is 40 C, and then give it this much power, 262 kilowatts at 256 newton meters and 1024 radians per second. With a friction heater, you can get this up to 1,000 degrees C. So now that we're heated up, how do we make bedrock ingots? Well, it's very simple. You just stick your bedrock dust in this slot here on the left, and you're going to need a multiple of 4. It's going to take 4 bedrock dust to make 1 steel ingot. So yes, if you want to make the tools, a pickaxe, I mean, you're going to have to break quite a bit of bedrock. Put a steel ingot in the top. Oh my goodness, why is it doing that? It wasn't doing that earlier. Why is it doing that? It doesn't want to stay at 1,000. Well, this wasn't doing this earlier, so I really don't know what to say about that. I guess just give it a little bit more power. I don't know, it wasn't doing that earlier, but now it doesn't want to stay, when I set this up previously in this exact same spot, this was at this friction heater was at like 1,004, so it wasn't dipping down under 1,000, but now it is, so I don't really know what the problem is. I have gotten this to work, but it doesn't seem to be working now. But, well, that's not good. I hate to end talking about the friction heater with a failure. But it was working before, so why isn't it working now? Oh, maybe the temperature on this block isn't as high as I would want it. Maybe I have to move it further over. But this worked earlier. Oh well, I'll test it and put an update in the description when I figure it out, because that was working like 10 minutes ago. Okay, so on that note, now that your confidence in me is soaring, let's talk about another way that you could heat up our blast furnace to 1,000 degrees, and also talk about another useful block in RotaryCraft. So, this is foolproof, by the way. This will work. So the heater is crafted like this, with 4 steel ingots, 2 base panels, iron bars, and a combustor. And the combustor is crafted using an ignition unit, which we learned how to craft when we talked about the gas engines, a piece of redstone dust, and 7 steel ingots like so. So craft yourself a heater, and I've already got it over here, and it's what it looks like. And this is its interface, it's GUI. So the way the heater works is that you can tell it what temperature to set itself to, and then you can have to give it fuel. And you also have to provide it with shaft power. So the heater requires 8192 watts minimum, but it requires that at a really high torque, according to this. So let's grab the heater. And it requires 16,000 newton meters of torque, which is quite a lot of torque. But you can get that with a gas engine. So you supply it with shaft power from the bottom, if I got a bevel gear under here, and then you give it fuel, and then it will heat up to whatever you tell it to heat up here. So we want this thing here to get blast furnace to get up to 1,000 C. So what I find is helpful is to set this to 1,100. And you'll find out why in a second. And then if you want to use a gas engine to power this heater, you're going to need a pretty high gear ratio, a 16 and an 8. And I didn't multiply that in my head, but that's quite a high ratio. But if I stick an 18, a 16, and 8 in here, now we're up to the 16384. So 16,000 newton meters and 4 radians per second, which is fine. And the operational time is 8 seconds. Now what this means is that every 8.8 seconds, the heater is going to consume whatever fuel, a bit of whatever fuel we put in here, and it try and increase its temperature back up to above this number. So better fuels, it'll burn anything you can put in a regular furnace, and better fuels give it more heat. So a lava bucket will instantly, once this operation takes over, give us 1,000. So now we're already over where we need to be. So that's an awesome way to get it jump started, using a bucket of lava. And then just throw a fuel source in there, like some charcoal. And then what'll happen is that it'll try and keep us up above 1,100. And the reason I like 1,100, of course you could probably use 1050 as well, is that if you set it straight for 1,000, this is going to kick itself up to 1,000, but then in the time it takes, in that 8.8 seconds, where before it can consume the next fuel, it'll probably drop below 1,000. So if you set it to 1,100, then you're guaranteed that by the time it processes that next piece of fuel, it's not going to be below 1,000. See right there, it kicked itself back up to 1,100 just before we fell below 1,000. So that works perfectly fine. So now that this is working, I don't know why, that I had that working earlier, I swear, was 4 bedrock dust and 1 steel ingot. And you see there it goes. And this is going to give us 1 bedrock ingot. And there it is, bedrock ingot. And you're going to need, obviously, however many of these that it takes for each tool. So 3 of these for a pick, and then 3 for an axe, 2 for a hoe, 1 for a shovel, 2 for a sword, and then a whole bunch of them for the armor pieces. So when you get your Bedrock Breaker working, decide what you want to use that Bedrock Dust for. I would probably get the pick first, to be quite honest. That's just because I think an indestructible pick with Silk Touch on it, would be really, really good. So let's take a few moments. This video is basically over, so I'm just gonna grab some of these tools, and we're gonna go test them out a bit. So these are the tools you can get. They're all indestructible. Remember. So we've got a bedrock pickaxe with Silk Touch 1, we've got a bedrock axe, shovel, hoe, shears, and a sword. So let's just go down this chasm and test out our bedrock pickaxe so you can see what you're going to be getting if you go ahead and do it. Well, it mines very quickly, as you can see. And it never breaks. So this is really, really, really good. If you haven't, if you still go around in caves and gather up resources manually, if you're not completely automating all of your mining, this is really, really good. I mean, you can see what it's doing. It's even destroying the dirt at a reasonable pace, but the shovel will break a bit quicker, although I don't know. I think that the pickaxes might actually be faster. What am I talking about? I'm in creative mode. Let's go back to... Somebody was probably going crazy. Okay, now that we're not in creative mode, and we can actually see how this, how well it works. So it's got Silk Touch, so obviously it gives us the ores. The pickaxe breaks dirt surprisingly fast. What about the shovel? Okay, the shovel just destroys dirt. So the shovel just massacres dirt, okay? And the pickaxe is pretty darn good. This speed, it seems to be on par with diamond. Maybe a bit faster, I don't know. It seems to be on par with it, though. But this won't ever break, and it's got Silk Touch. So let's go back to creative. Fly up, and we'll test out the axe. I just want to show you guys how good these tools are so that you can, you know, figure out if you want to go for these tools or if you'd rather use your bedrock for something else. So let's go back to survival. Oh! That was loud. My goodness, that scared the heck out of me. Why was that so loud? But apparently it does tree cap. Did it? Okay. Apparently this axe is the most amazing tree capitation axe I have ever seen. So it chops down entire trees pretty much instantly, and it will also chop down trees that are touching other trees. Okay, so you could literally chop down an entire forest with one swing of this axe. So this is pretty darn good. Oh my goodness, it'll chop down all these trees. Okay, a bit of lag. The game doesn't really like it, apparently. But oh my goodness. So yeah, this axe is pretty darn good. I think we can agree, and of course the shovel, really good at, on dirt. But so this axe is ridiculously good. What is the hoe? Oh, so the hoe hoes a very large area. Honestly, I don't know. I think I would only make a hoe out of bedrock if I had nothing else to do with my bedrock. I don't really see. I mean, this is kind of nice, but I don't see it as a good use of bedrock. Let's talk about the shears now. Okay, so it doesn't shear an entire tree's leaves all at once, but it does shear ridiculously quickly, and of course it's unbreakable, so that would be kind of nice. And now, sword. Let's find something to kill. There's a chicken over here, but you know it's not really gonna give us a. Wow, we got a lot of feathers from that. 14 feathers from one chicken. That's because of looting. So the sword will get you tons of loot. The axe will chop down entire forests with a single swing. The shovel will destroy dirt like no tomorrow. And the pickaxe has Silk Touch. And they're all unbreakable. And the same goes for the armor. They're all unbreakable. They all have a useful enchant. So you guys can decide what you want to do with your bedrock. The tools are definitely worth it. I probably would not build the hoe. I probably wouldn't build the shears either, but until I had nothing else to do with it. But there you go. So if you just want to make machines, go ahead and get your bedrock dust. If you want to make these awesome tools, go ahead and make your Bedrock Ingots using the heater. I will figure out how, why this wasn't working the way it was earlier, and then I will post in the description later if I do how I managed to get this friction heater one to work. But, you know, you can definitely use the heater. One more thing I want to mention is when I would use the friction heater or the heater. Obviously, this friction heater, you can power it off of an infinite power source, whereas this heater always requires some sort of fuel. But you can get it going a lot faster with the heater, like you saw, just dump in a lava block bucket and then put in some charcoal and it'll go for quite a while. But so yeah, you can decide what you want to do there, how you power the heater. The heater does require a lot less power than the friction heater does to get to that same speed. But anyway, I hope you enjoyed the episode. I'm not sure what we're talking about next episode. I'll figure it out, and I'll get back to you on that later. But I hope you've enjoyed the episode and learned something about the mod. I'm SentinalhMC, and I'm signing out.